Lightning is a phenomenon that has always had a profound effect upon man. In cultures all over the world, man has always identified the power and magnificence of lightning and thunder with his gods and goddesses. When Yahweh appeared to Moses on Mount Sinai, his coming was signaled by thunder and lightning. For the Chinese, lightning was a goddess, Tian Mu. She produced her lightning from mirrors which she held in each hand. For the Indians, lightning bolts emanated from Indra. For the Greeks, from Zeus. And for the Scandinavians, from Thor. For the Indians of North America, lightning flashed from the eyes of the thunderbird, while thunderclaps came from the beating of his wings. But in 1752 AD, a man suggested that there was yet another way to think of lightning, as electricity. That man was Benjamin Franklin. How Franklin came to make his discovery can certainly be traced to the development of science and the experimental method in the West, but it can also be traced to a less obvious source. Amber. Amber is the fossilized resin or sap of prehistoric trees and plants. It is easily carved and polished and is characterized by a resinous luster. A negative charge can be built up on a piece of amber when it is rubbed by fur or wool cloth. People touching it might experience a small shock. Amber has always been prized by man. Prehistoric man wore it in the form of beads and carved it into animal forms. This amber bear dates from 9,000 to 5,000 BC in Denmark and was probably used in bear cult rituals. Ancient man used amber as a means of exchange and commerce. The Greeks, great traders, were familiar with amber and gave it the name electron, from which the modern words electron and electricity are derived. But what is important for our story is that in 1600, in a book entitled De Magneti, William Gilbert, an English physician and physicist, and the founder of the science of magnetism, reported that not only amber, but other substances could attract objects if they were rubbed. He named these subjects electrics. Soon experimenters everywhere were rubbing electrics. In other words, generating static electricity. This led to the creation of a series of friction machines that included sulfur balls and glass globes, and finally culminated in the Leyden jar, an electrical storage condenser created by Professor van Musschenbroek in Leyden, Holland in 1745. Leyden jars and static electricity became something of a fad. Franklin got one and began to make observations and experiments of his own. One of his observations was that there were two kinds of electricity, vitreous or glass-based, and resinous or amber-based. We now refer to these as positive and negative, as we'll see later. More importantly, Franklin also observed that the swift, crooked motion and noise of the static electricity from a Leyden jar resembled lightning, and he proposed his famous kite experiment to prove that they were indeed one and the same phenomenon. But even though this established a connection between the visible manifestations of lightning and static electricity, more work needed to be done before electricity could become a complete science. Western man's unique outlook on the world, beginning as far back as medieval times, has always been to seek out the secrets of nature. This same attitude can be traced throughout the history of the West, right up to the current building of particle accelerators to seek out the secrets of subatomic particles. The idea of using the experimental method combined with the power of mathematics to pry open nature's secrets is also as old as medieval times. In 1266, Roger Bacon, a Franciscan monk who also meditated upon steam engines, steam ships, and airplanes, praised the experimental method but added that no science can be known without mathematics. Therefore, once Franklin's experiment had proven that lightning was a form of electricity, the race was on to find the mathematical laws of electricity. In the late 1780s, less than 40 years after Franklin's kite experiment, Charles Augustin de Coulomb, a French engineer, devised a torsion balance and used it to measure electrostatic and magnetic forces with great accuracy. The result of this work was his discovery of what is now called Coulomb's law, the basic mathematical law of electrical charges. Included in this law is the fact that like charges repel and unlike charges attract. After this, the science of electricity developed rapidly. In 1800, Count Alessandro Volta created the first battery, called the voltaic pile. It consisted of bowls of salt solution connected by arcs of metal, one end copper, the other tin. Volta's primitive battery was the first man-made source of continuous electricity. 20 years later, in 1820, Hans Christian Oersted, a Danish physicist, published the results of an experiment that he had performed a year before. In his experiment, a magnetic needle was deflected by an electric current. After learning of Oersted's discovery, the way electricity and magnetism were related came to André-Marie Ampère, a French physicist, in a flash. Within a week, he had worked out the basics of his new theory of electrodynamics. 11 years later, in 1831, Michael Faraday, a self-educated English physicist from a poor family, discovered electromagnetic induction, the method for converting magnetism into electricity, and built the first generator. To this day, electromagnetic induction produces the electricity that powers the lights, appliances, and machines in our homes, offices, and factories. 34 years later, in 1865, James Clerk Maxwell published A Dynamical Theory on the Electromagnetic Field. Building on Faraday's work and discoveries, Maxwell predicted electromagnetic waves. 22 years later, in 1887, the young German physicist Heinrich Hertz produced electromagnetic waves using Maxwell's equations. The production of electromagnetic waves makes radio, television, and satellite transmission possible. Then, 10 years later, in 1897, the Englishman, Sir Joseph John Thomson, working with cathode rays, the basis for the video image you are watching now, discovered the electron itself. Thus, in less than a century and a half, after Franklin had shown that lightning was electricity, the electron, the basis for electricity itself, had been discovered, and the science of electricity was well on the way to becoming the complete science that is responsible for the astounding technological achievements of our modern world.